I was driving to my office in Manhattan a few days ago. There was a homeless person, and he had abandoned his usual post on the sidewalk, and he was standing in the middle of the intersection. Why? Because there was a traffic jam. So apparently he decided that because it was his intersection, he had to do something about it because there were no police officers around. So he's standing in the middle of the intersection, telling cars in one direction to stop, and then motioning cars in the other direction to come forward. There's a truck driver that he's stopping who goes crazy, slamming on his horn, and the homeless guy's looking at him like, "You got a problem? I'm the king of this intersection. You got to listen to me." Which, of course, made sense, because as we all know,
it's good to be the king.
It's good to be the king. There's another king that we read about in this week's Torah portion. The king that the Jews are supposed to appoint after they settle the land of Israel. Now that's very strange. Why do we need another king? We already have a king. God is our king up in heaven. The answer, of course, is that the Jewish king is supposed to be God's representative down on earth. He's supposed to inspire his subjects through his personal example of nobility and humility. He's supposed to exhort and cajole and assist his Jewish subjects in coming closer to God and help them observe the commandments. When it works, it's unbelievable. It worked one time in Jewish history, during the reign of David HaMelech, King David. And think about his legacy. Even though David HaMelech was an incredible warrior, he didn't leave behind books about war or power like Machiavelli or Sun Tzu. Instead, he left behind Tehillim, Psalms, that continue to inspire people, Jews and non-Jews, across the world to this day to come closer to God. David's son was Shlomo HaMelech, King Solomon, who is known as the wisest man who ever lived. But despite his extraordinary wisdom, he made a tragic error. He looked at this week's Torah portion, saw that God says the king of the Jews is not supposed to marry too many wives because they'll lead his heart astray. And King Solomon said, "Wait a second, that doesn't apply to me. Why? Because I've spent so much time working on myself that I've become a master of my thoughts and my emotions. I can marry more than the recommended allowance of wives, and it won't affect me." Footnote, by the way, to my wife, I think one is the perfect number of wives. But to King Solomon, he said, "I can marry as many as I want." And he did. He exceeded the recommended allowance. And what do you know? They led his heart astray. But how is that possible? He was the wisest man who ever lived. How did he make that miscalculation? An answer I saw that's incredible is that he did not miscalculate. He was right. He was the master of his thoughts and emotions, and on paper, no matter how many wives he married, they wouldn't have led him astray. But God said, if a king does this, he will be led astray. So it was bound to happen. And that's a cautionary tale for us. Because once we start to play that game, saying, "Well, I know the reason for the commandment, and it doesn't apply to me, so I don't have to do that one. I know that the kosher laws were ancient laws that were meant to keep people healthy, but nowadays we can stay healthy while eating non-kosher." That's wrong. The reason we keep kosher is because God said so. Or if we start playing this game, "I'll do anything God tells me to do as long as he explains it. Don't murder, that makes sense. Don't steal, that makes sense. But don't mix wool and linen in your garment, I don't understand that one, so I'm not going to do it." Those are examples of a phenomenon that a famous rabbi once called mankind hauling God down into the courtroom of man where he does not belong. Instead of God hauling man by the scruff of our necks into the courtroom of God where we do belong. Rosh Hashanah is around the corner. We have to use all of our spare moments preparing ourselves for that once a year re-coronation of our king. We have to get ready to re-crown God, not just the king of the world, but as our individual king. All hail the king.
Now come the days of the king.
This day does not belong to one man, but to all. Let us together rebuild this world, that we may share in the days of peace.